We are old souls, protectors of the earth, guardians of children, worshippers of the moon, mermaids of the ocean. We are followers of the sun and women of magic. We are witches. We protect nature and fight against darkness. And we live in harmony amongst ourselves and protect each other at all costs. I carry the spirits of the ancients and come from a long line of wise women of the Taino and Yoruban people from deep in the Caribbean. Witches who lived by nature.
Princess Nakaya. Welcome once again to the Radical Imagination. I'm your host, Jim Vrettos. I'm a sociologist who's taught at John Jay College and Yeshiva University here in New York. Our world's climate crisis is immediate, profound, severe, and life-threatening to much of the world's population, resources, and species. It's killing us and is the greatest threat, along with nuclear war, to our survival. We desperately need a radical imagination that is able to grasp and address the issue intellectually, scientifically, morally, politically, and economically. A transformative new narrative with practical and concrete policies, actions, and solutions that can turn the crisis around. It's zero hour. There are guidelines and lessons from our past that can be beacons for the way forward. We've had chances in the past to address these issues and didn't. We have to incorporate these same age-old lessons now, once and for all, or else. It's zero hour. If we look at the ancient insights of Torah, as Rabbi Otto Waskow of the Shalom Center has about healing the relationship of Earth and human earthlings, they are echoed in modern science. In Leviticus 25:26 and Deuteronomy 15, they call for 1 year out of every seven to be a sabbatical year, a year of restful release for the earth and its workers, from being made to work and of release for debtors from all their debts. The Torah warns us that if we refuse to let the earth rest, it will rest anyway, despite us and upon us, through drought and famine and exile that turn an entire people into refugees. This ageless warning has now become a crisis of our planet as a whole and of the entire human species. Human behavior that overworks the earth, especially the overburning of fossil fuels, has brought about a systemic planetary response that endangers human communities and many other life forms as well. Scientific projections of the future make clear that even worse will happen if we continue with carbon burning business as usual. The Reverend William Barber, resurrecting Martin Luther King's Poor People's Campaign of 1968, has integrated environmental justice as a major part of the platform. Racial inequality influences the way we understand climate change. Barber puts it very clearly. Jesus said, "Love your neighbor." I don't care how many times you tell me you love me, if you put coal ash in my water, you don't love me. Because if there is nothing wrong with the coal ash, then put it in the wealthy communities. Barber points to a passage in Genesis in which God gives man dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. But as he further points out, dominion in this sense means to care for, not destroy. The first commandment is to take care of creation. To destroy creation is fundamentally irreligious. It's a violation. It's a sin. Earth is the only place we have to live. Jesus never said we must help corporations poison the water. And Barber often wears a sash that reads, "Jesus was a poor man." It's zero hour. As Barber further puts it, we should understand the connections between systemic racism, poverty, ecological devastation, the war economy, and militarism, and an excessive materialism that fosters a distorted moral narrative of Christian nationalism. They are interlocking injustices. We can't ignore any of them. It's zero hour. Our guest today on The Radical Imagination is a terrific young woman who is the founder and co-executive director of an international youth climate justice movement called, you guessed it, Zero Hour, that led to the very first youth climate march in Washington, D.C., and more than 25 cities around the world during the summer of 2018. She's planning a second climate summit, which will be held this summer, July 12th, in Miami. She's also a plaintiff on Our Children's Trust Youth versus Gov Washington State lawsuit, suing the state of Washington for denying her generation's constitutional rights to a livable environment by continuing to make climate change worse. Certainly sounds like an interesting lawsuit which we'll all be following. Jamie is a Colombian-American writer, public speaker, and a climate justice organizer and activist in her local community of Seattle. Zero Hour is an environmentally focused, youth-led, creatively minded, and technologically savvy nationwide coalition movement who are sounding the alarm and call for action on climate change and environmental justice. They are an inclusive movement taking heed of what we see as the greatest crisis threatening their generation. She was introduced to me by my good friends and comrades, Nick Brana and Carol Earle from the People's Party movement, who described her as, quote unquote, a kick-ass Latina organizer and activist that I had to have on this show. In the 4 years of doing this show, I don't think I've introduced anyone as kick-ass. I'm very pleased to introduce her as the first. And her first book, Youth to Power, The Ultimate Guide to Being a Young Activist, will hit bookstores worldwide in 2020. I'm sure that will make her a kick-ass author too. It's a terrific honor and privilege to welcome Jamie Margolin to The Radical Imagination. Thank you so much, Jamie, for being here. It's really
Thank you for having me.
Terrific. Terrific. There you are. Tell us a little bit about your background, how you got started in the movement and helped found Zero Hour.
Yeah, so being someone who was born after 9/11, there has never been a moment in my life that the climate crisis was not looming over me and my entire generation. It's not like many adults who just learned about it through like an Inconvenient Truth or just like a single documentary or learned about it very recently. This crisis has been looming over my life and all of the decisions I want to make ever since I can remember. As a young person, I'm constantly being asked to plan my future. What do you want to be when you grow up? What do you want to do? What college are you going to go to? I'm going into my senior year of high school, so that means that's going to be asked a lot. But it's hard to plan for a future when you don't even know if it's going to exist. And like, how do you plan for a future on an unlivable planet descending into climate breakdown and climate chaos? So I've had that fear looming over me for a long time. And it wasn't until about 2016 that I really, when I was 14 years old, that I really started to take action, because no one tells young people like myself exactly how to take action. There is no instruction manual, which is why I'm writing the book, and there is no one just tells us how to get involved. So I was just there sitting with that worry for a long time until the 2016 election. An email popped up around in my inbox. I think it was like an automatic email alert from the Democratic Seattle campaign headquarters. This was around the general election when it was very clear that it was between either Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton. And to me, that was a no-brainer. So I went and I started volunteering at the Democratic campaign quarters in Seattle. It was my first time being a part of something bigger than myself. And I was just organizing. I became an intern there. I was like practically living in the campaign office. And I thought that by doing that work and getting and keeping a climate denier out of office, I would be doing my part to stop the climate crisis. But that didn't go well. And then I later realized that it simply having someone in office who says they believe in climate change is not enough. That does not constitute a climate champion, and that does not make it enough to stand up to this crisis. So I joined a local environmental organization here in my hometown of Seattle called Plant for the Planet. Around December of 2016, I started volunteering, I started attending meetings, I started lobbying, I started working on local grassroots initiatives here in Seattle. And really, the more I did, the more I learned, the more I realized how urgent this is, and the more I realized how bad our politicians actually are at like solving this, and how insufficient even the climate champions are being on taking action. So the more I did, the more I realized how much more needs to be done. And so I did this work for about 2 years in Seattle, and no one was paying attention to us, and no one was really listening. There was no press coverage. There was no, we were working in the shadows pretty much, doing the best we could with what we had, pretty much working full time outside of myself being in high school. And so I had an idea ever since the first Women's March of a youth climate march on Washington, of young people rising up and demanding an end to business as usual on the climate crisis and shining light on the injustice that is being done to us. That had never been done before, like a big mainstream youth climate march that has been covered. And so I realized that I need to be the one to start it, because if I don't, who will? But for a while, I didn't, because I was still really nervous. A national mobilization takes so much work, takes so much dedication, takes so much effort. And I didn't know if I was prepared for that, and I didn't know how to do that. So I kind of pushed the idea down until about the summer of 2017. The hurricanes happened, Hurricane Harvey, Hurricane Maria, and all of these natural disasters that completely devastated so many parts of the world. And then to make matters worse, here in Seattle, there was massive wildfires that happened in Canada, that blew over Seattle and just covered the entire city in smog. And so the entire city, it was almost our air quality was like worse than Beijing, China, for a few days. It was terrible. I had never experienced anything like that. And so all of these things added up, and it was just the perfect storm of like, you know what, screw it. We have to organize this march because all of these climate disasters are happening. It's literally apocalyptic. And the media and our leaders are just going on like, oh, that's a large hurricane. Okay, cool. We're just going to stand. You know, they stand in the middle of the storm and report it. Everything's flooding and all that, but they don't actually talk about the climate crisis. And around that same time, the United States pulled out of the Paris Accord. So it was then that I just decided to jump in, start organizing Zero Hour. I posted on my social media account on Instagram that I was going to organize a youth climate march and asked who wanted to join me. And a few young people reached out and said, I'll join you. I'll help. One of them, which is my current co-executive director, Nadia Nazar. And we just started going from there, working from there. And so we spent almost an entire year organizing, building, mobilizing. We had nothing. No money, no notoriety, no, like, none of us come from rich families, political families, or famous families, so there was nothing to fall back on. But just through grit and determination and hard work, over the course of a year, we built this movement. And then on July 21st of 2018, we marched on Washington. And 25 cities around the world, other young people joined us.
And you're preparing for another one this summer.
Yes.
Right, in Miami. It's youth-led, but it's intergenerational, and you do have coalition partners as well now?
We do. We have tons of partners. Many, many organizations work with us, and it's intergenerational in that we have adult mentors on our team, and anyone can, for example, for the Youth Climate Summit in Miami that is taking place July 12th through the 14th, anyone can attend of all ages.
And the way to get in touch with you would be
so the way to get in touch with me is through social media. So I'm on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook, but the best way to reach me is through Instagram and Twitter. If you put in Jamie Margolin into Instagram or into Twitter and just follow me, it's my face. It's a youth climate activist.
We'll find you.
So that's the way to get in touch with me personally, is just Jamie Margolin on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook. But if you want to get in touch with Zero Hour as an organization, really get involved with the movement, go to thisiszerohour.org. And on there, you can register for the summit. It is not too late. I know it's coming up, but registration is still open and we still have capacity for more people to attend. So you can register for the summit. You can donate, because we are a completely grassroots, volunteer-run organization. We have no staff. I do not get paid to do this work. In fact, I hemorrhage money doing this work on the opposite side. We really rely on grassroots donations. You can read more about us. We have a press page. You can, if you're a press and you want to reach out to us and do an interview with one of the many young people who work with us, you can go to like the media page. And then we're on social media. It's just This Is Zero Hour on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. And that's how you get in touch with us. And we have people constantly monitoring those accounts. You can also email info@thisiszerohour.org if you have a special inquiry or request for someone from our team or an organization or a question. So we're very reachable. We're very tech savvy. So just the internet is the best way to reach us.
It sounds like it. And you have this incredible TED Talk that we're going to be listening to in just a minute or two. It's just incredible. This is not just a one-shot sort of summit, right? I mean, you're really analytically, systematically trying to come up with answers, solutions, and an analysis. And this is a brilliant talk. It's a little longer than we usually have on a clip, but it's so incredibly wonderful and ties in the issues of poverty and racism, colonialism, patriarchy, and so on, that what we've decided to do is show you on this clip here for the next several minutes. So here you are on your TED Talk.
Yes.
By solving these issues, we're both addressing the roots of the climate crisis and solving the social justice issues that oppress us. So it's a win-win. Many people pin the start of the climate crisis to the Industrial Revolution. That was when we started digging for coal, mining fossil fuels out of the ground, and burning them. But it actually started long before that. Colonization started the climate crisis and all of the practices it brought. With colonization, European settlers destroyed natural habitats, hunted species to death, and brought in invasive plant species that indigenous and African slaves were forced to grow. With colonialism came the extreme extraction of the earth and the genocide and silencing of the indigenous wisdom of the peoples that have been keeping this earth alive for centuries. With colonialism came the idea that everything on this earth is made for our extraction and that everything is to be bought and sold. According to an article about early Western colonialism in Encyclopedia Britannica, when colonizers arrived to the Americas, they immediately thought of the land, the water, and all of the natural resources in front of them as theirs to claim and extract. Why this entitlement? Because unless someone had explicitly bought the land with a system of currency they valued, it was seen as free pickings. So with colonialism came the idea that nothing, not air, not water, not trees, not animals, not land, was sacred or priceless. And this mindset is the core of how we got to climate disaster. So that's why before the first coal was mined, even before the first factories were opened, the seeds for the climate crisis had already been planted. And the colonialism that caused the climate crisis is still playing out today. For example, former colonized countries emit the least amount of carbon dioxide, but feel the worst effects of the climate crisis. And even though, yes, countries in the global south, like India, do emit large amounts of pollutants, it is because the United States ships our factories overseas so poor people of color can do our dirty work. American corporations save money exploiting workers in India and polluting their air, water, and people. While the poor communities are poisoned and suffer, rich communities in the United States buy these products and enjoy the luxuries of these products without actually having to feel the toxic effects of producing them. It's the same colonial system of forcing people of color to produce and pay the price for luxuries for those in rich white countries. Colonialism never went away. It just evolved. And then there's a next system of oppression very much intertwined with colonialism, racism. There's compelling evidence that increasing social inequality is linked to environmental degradation, and that the health of people of color and those living in poverty is negatively impacted by being exposed to higher levels of environmental pollutants than their white and wealthy counterparts. The vast majority of fossil fuel projects and energy extraction sites are built in low-income communities, immigrant communities, and communities of color. Why? Because these communities are already victims of the racist system of oppression, and governments and corporations can exploit their vulnerability. A 2008 report, co-authored by the NRDC, reviewed data collected over 20 years and found that more than half the people living within 2 miles of toxic waste facilities in the United States are people of color. A report in 2016 by the Center for Effective Government, now called the Project for Governmental Oversight, found that people of color are nearly twice as likely as white residents to live within a fence line zone of an industrial facility. The effects of the climate crisis, such as extreme weather conditions, have devastating consequences for communities of color and low-income communities. In the aftermath of such disasters, efforts to rebuild communities of color and low-income communities are often completely inadequate compared to efforts to rebuild higher-income and white communities. The most powerful example of this inequity is the communities of color in New Orleans that were affected by Hurricane Katrina. Black homeowners received $8,000 less per family in government aid than white homeowners due to disparities in housing values. In 2013, about 80% of the mostly black residents of the city's Lower Ninth Ward had not returned to their community due to inadequate recovery and rebuilding efforts by the government. None of these examples are a coincidence. Because people of color and immigrants are already victims of racism, they're more vulnerable to corporations targeting them. Because wealthy white citizens have the money, power, and our current racist system on their side, corporations would not be able to get away with building toxic chemical or extraction plants in those wealthy white neighborhoods. Take, for example, the Dakota Access Pipeline. A fossil fuel pipeline designed to transport up to 500,000 barrels of crude oil daily from North Dakota to Illinois. According to ABC News, the construction of the pipeline was originally going to be built through a majority white and non-indigenous community. But when that community rejected it, in the interest of protecting their water and the health of their citizens, It was then rerouted to instead be built on indigenous land. And even though there was massive pushback against the construction of this pipeline on the sacred indigenous land, the outcry of the native peoples was ultimately not respected at all, and the pipeline was built anyway on the indigenous land. Prominent activist Reverend Jesse Jackson called the reroute of the Dakota Access Pipeline the ripest case of environmental racism I've seen in a long time. On top of colonialism and racism, there is another system of oppression affecting us, patriarchy. Women are more affected by the climate crisis than men. Roles as primary caregivers and providers of food and fuel for our communities make us more vulnerable when flooding and drought occur. According to the BBC, in Central Africa, where up to 90% of Lake Chad has disappeared, nomadic indigenous groups are particularly at risk. As the lake shoreline recedes, women have to walk farther and farther to collect water for their communities. In the dry season, men head off to the towns, leaving women to take care of their communities. With dry seasons now becoming longer and longer due to climate change, women are working harder and harder to feed and care for our families without support and with less and less resources. That's an example of the climate crisis disproportionately affecting women, and women, being victims of patriarchy, having the burden of dealing with the effects of the climate crisis and it falling on our shoulders. And it is not just women in rural areas who are affected. Women are more likely than men to experience poverty and have less socioeconomic power, according to the United Nations. This makes it difficult to recover from disasters which affect infrastructure, jobs, and housing. Due to the patriarchal system of oppression that has been holding us back for thousands and thousands of years, we are more affected by the climate crisis, even as we bear the weight of rebuilding and caring for our communities after disaster. This is how systems of oppression intertwine with the climate crisis. People of color, women, poor folks, people with disabilities, people with chronic illnesses, queer people, homeless folks, everyone who is already oppressed, vulnerable, and disadvantaged by society is disproportionately affected by the climate crisis. And these same systems of oppression also helped cause the climate crisis. Now, climate change on its own seems like a huge and insurmountable problem by itself. Factor in the full story and the problem becomes even bigger than that. In order to save our lives, futures, the planet, and everything we hold dear, change needs to happen on a much bigger scale than we initially thought. Climate change demands much bigger and harder solutions than we initially thought. The media, our leaders, businesses, and global corporations need to address climate change not as a standalone issue floating separately from everything else, but instead as the grand culmination of all our societal injustices that have been building up for centuries. And it is our responsibility to speak truth to power, call out these systems of oppression, and demand the livable earth that we all deserve. We have to demand that those in power get to the roots of the climate crisis and tackle the systems of oppression that caused it in the first place. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Jamie. Brilliant. We've been looking for that sort of analysis.
Hi, Barbara Corcoran here from Sherman.
We've been exploring this analysis on that show for the past 4 years, and you've done a terrific job articulating the interconnectedness and the morality of the need to bring in the economic, political, psychological, and moral analysis in all of this. So in your mind, it starts with the colonialism, the need to what? Dominate, control, exploit. Is this something we've learned as a species? Is this something we can unlearn?
No, still colonized. Like, there's still, colonization is still happening.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Like, we are still colonizing, colonization is still happening, and a lot of times some of the problematic quote-unquote solutions to the climate crisis are trying to colonize our way out of this issue that is caused by colonization.
Give us an example. Give us the audience a concrete example of what you're talking about, because I think you're absolutely right there.
Of colonizing our way. Well, for example, one of them is cap and trade. Which is kind of enforcing these kind of broad solutions onto communities that are feeling the worst effects of the climate crisis and still giving corporations the ability to keep polluting while these communities still feel the worst effects of the climate crisis. Mm-hmm. There is continuing of snatching land from indigenous people and violate the continual violation of treaty rights. If you're looking for examples of modern day colonialism, we keep going into other countries, we keep messing stuff up there, interfering.
So our military wars.
Military interference, and then also trying to impose our own solutions and our own, like each community knows what's best for itself, but here, in the United States and a lot of countries keep trying to impose their practices and everything onto these communities, right, which is extremely harmful. And so it's not like we're just recovering from past colonization. Like, people are still being colonized. Like, the colonization is still happening, and that we cannot colonize our way out of a crisis caused by colonizing. And so when you look at the people in power, the people who have done the colonizing and who support those kinds of policies, also proposing climate solutions that kind of like maintain the power structure, it just doesn't work. So a lot of times what a lot of, I guess, centrist climate solutions are proposing is really trying to solve this issue caused by all these power structures and all this violence, maintaining that same system of violence, which just doesn't work. I like to describe it best this way. Einstein describes the definition of insanity as trying to solve an issue with the same thinking that caused it, and that is what a lot of the climate community is doing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. What about the Green New Deal? Is that something that you're positive about? I know there's been a lot of talk about it, there's some confusion and so on. How do you respond to those, to that initiative?
I am hopeful about the Green New Deal. You know, with a piece of legislation, like, there's always going to be pros and cons, but being that it was brought forward by Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, I feel like Alexandria is one of the few politicians who really gets the interconnectedness of all of this, okay, who gets the social justice impact, and so the fact that this bill is being brought by people who are the first politicians, I feel like, who are really understanding that link and how this is going to affect communities is, like, it's a great start.
It is. Okay, so there is a certain small group within the political system that you feel you can work with. But
yes,
other than that, it's going to have to be what? Local mobilization of people, raising of consciousness, and working on it at a local level? Is that the major thrust at this point?
We have to attack this issue at all angles. There still has to be work on the national level. There also has to be, at the same time, work on the local level. When we're in such an emergency, it's not an either-or kind of thing. It's just, how much can you do? Like, everyone doing everything as much as they can, as fast as they can. That's really what an emergency response is and what needs to happen.
What about links to a rather feeble anti-war movement in the country? We're going to have a show in a couple of weeks on that as well. But,
I think the military-industrial complex is very much linked with the climate crisis.
Right.
So, the United States military pollutes more than most small countries and combined. And so we have to address, if we're going to address carbon and the climate crisis, we can't just pick and choose about what's convenient and what we want to address. It also means talking about the hard stuff, like the fact that our military, which continues to colonizing and go in and cause all sorts of problems, is also worsening the climate crisis. And so that is something that we cannot ignore and that we need to talk about and that we need to work on and kind of address and be like, the United States military pollutes more than most small countries combined. Like, that in itself is really something.
How much do you see your movement influencing politicians? Any of the candidates you see worth your energy, no pun intended there, directing
candidates
hope,
like, endorsed a specific candidate yet, because there isn't like a candidate that I'm like, yes, 100%. There are some that I'm like, absolutely not, like, no way. Like, Joe Biden, absolutely not. He literally wants to find a middle ground between fossil fuel industries, which is pretty much just a form of climate denial. It's sick. There are a lot of like the other like kind of centrist, like, guys who are probably not going to make it that long. They kind of look like every pasty white man ever. Those guys at the debates, like, I 100% know. But I feel like there are some candidates that I'm just like, I'm kind of waiting and seeing, like I'm, but kind of waiting and seeing a little skeptically, because, like, for example, Beto O'Rourke, during the debate, he was saying that I think that climate change is the most defining issue of our time, but he's really only been speaking out against climate change since young people like us in the Sunrise Movement and Zero Hour have really been putting pressure.
Right.
And also
right.
He has a huge history of fossil fuel dependency and fossil fuel, like fossil fuel ties. And so, and even Jay Inslee, the governor of Washington, I'm kind of suing him. I mean, I work with his, like it's not, I'm not suing him personally. I'm suing the state of Washington along with 12 other young people. But like, for me, I feel like there's hope there and he's like really onto something. But I kind of, with every candidate, they have something good, but then I always have to hold on to kind of take everything with a grain of salt.
Yeah.
Because like with Inslee, he speaks amazing, but then like, what can he do? Because
he's part of the structure that's still perpetuating the policies.
Not just that, but here in Seattle, Washington, I'm his constituent, and like we still have, like I haven't seen the progress here. So if it can't happen in Washington State, how's it gonna?
Well,
but then I'm also like,
tell us about the lawsuit if you can for just a couple minutes.
Yeah,
that sounds
yeah,
so
and
interesting.
Also to clear up, like for me, it's kind of interesting because like I like we haven't confirmed this yet, but Inslee might be participating in our summit in some way. And so like for me with these politicians, it's a balance of critiquing them, but also like seeing how I can work with them. So even politicians that I don't agree with fully, or that even I'm kind of in a lawsuit with, like Inslee, like I'm still friendly with his campaign staff, friendly with him, and like kind of seeing what we can do, because in the end I don't benefit from picking fights with my leaders. It's not fun. It's not, doesn't help anyone. But I have to pick those fights if they're not going to do what they need to do. So the lawsuit. So this lawsuit actually started even before I came onto it. So the lawsuit started about, I think it was before the 2016 election, where young people petitioned the Department of Ecology to come up with the Clean Air Rule and really just take more action on climate. The Department of Ecology was like, that's not our job, which is hilarious because that is literally in their job description, is to protect the local environment, but okay. And so I'm not gonna go through like the back and forth,
right,
the court battle, but pretty much this is the gist of what happened. Youth extend hand to friendship saying, hey government, I wanna work with you. Government is just like, oh, sorry, that's not our job. You should like ask the courts and or ask someone else, like go ask your mom, go ask your dad kind of thing. And then after trying to extend the hand of friendship for so long, the young people are like, well, shoot, nothing's going to happen. We have to, it moved on to a constitutional case of like, okay, now we're suing the government because we tried to work with them like in a friendly way. And now we're just like, listen, you are physically denying our rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness by actively making the climate crisis worse. And by, you know, continuing to allow fossil fuel projects to be built. There are new fossil fuel projects still being built in my home of Washington. There is the Tacoma Liquid Natural Gas Terminal, which is built on indigenous land. I'm pretty sure violates some treaty rights, but I have to double check the stats on that. But that's what the Puyallup tribe has been literally putting their bodies on the line trying to stop it. There's like the methanol refineries. There's all sorts of new, there's the Kalama methanol refinery. There's just all these new fossil fuel infrastructure being built in Seattle, not in Seattle, the city itself, not the downtown area, but like in Washington. And it's continuing to harm communities, continuing. So how can they do this? That is actively denying our rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Because without clean air, clean water, and a livable future, how are you going to have life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness as guaranteed to us in the Declaration of Independence,
Absolutely.
As well as in the public trust doctrine of the Washington State Constitution? So what happened is we're kind of in the appeal mode now of the case because it was kind of struck down by the courts. The courts did not rule in our favor, so now we're appealing that. They were pretty much not letting it go to trial. So it's just been this legal back and forth that's been going on for years, and we'll see what happens with that. But it's not looking too great right now, but we're still fighting.
All right. Well, you might look into connecting with Reverend Barber and Poor People's Campaign, because he is, in a sense, also in the courts on a variety of issues to achieve rights for poor people, voting rights, and so on. So there's some connections, I think, that you both have there.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, Reverend William Barber of Poor People's Campaign. Now, this is really going to be an international summit, right? You're going to have people from all over the world. Who's going to be there? How many people you're expecting?
So we're expecting around 200 to 300 people, maybe 400 people. It really depends. It also depends on if you register. So if you want to go to thisiszerohour.org, okay. I'm saying you as in you interviewing me, but also everyone watching.
Absolutely.
So everyone watching, because we have capacity for even more.
But it's going to be. Is Greta Thunberg?
Greta Thunberg is not coming in person because she doesn't fly.
Okay.
But she is calling in via Skype. We have a few. Probably presidential candidates calling in via Skype, though they haven't been confirmed yet. We have in person the leaders of the Standing Rock movement, the young leaders who started the Standing Rock movement. We got Little Miss Flint, who is a young activist fighting for water rights in Flint, Michigan, and making sure that we don't forget Flint and that huge environmental crisis. We have some organizers from the Bronx, from the organization Uprose, as well as Daphne Frias, who is another kick-ass young Latina woman who just won a local election, and she's 21, so she's pretty amazing. We have the Zero Hour team is going to be speaking, leading workshops, showing people like how to build a movement. So I will be speaking, and my fellow teammates will also be speaking and talking about, built this movement from scratch, and we had to learn the hard way. And so we're helping all the young people and older people there, of just giving them all the skills that we've learned. Gina McCarthy is going to be there, former EPA administrator. Bill McKibben, Dan Hayes, who's one of the founders of Earth Day. Just so many amazing young people from all around the country and the world. We're going to have some young activists from my family's home country of Colombia who are fighting to protect the Amazon call into the summit. We have someone flying out from Uganda for our global panel.
Wow.
We have, it's just the list goes on and on and
Incredible.
On. And it will be on the website soon. But the point is, this is really, it's not just another conference. It's really a mass mobilization and convening. I like to think of it as a more sophisticated march. It is still very much a protest. And over the span of July 12th through the 14th, there's going to be a lot of magic and movement building happening. I'm really excited.
It sounds fabulous. Unbelievable. We're going to show a short little clip now, too, on a little more about your work and the summit.
Perfect.
I'm constantly being asked, especially in high school, to plan for my future, plan for college. What am I going to be when I grow up? And I'm like, will there be a world for me to be growing up in that is livable, that looks anything like the world I'm growing up in today? This is the defining issue of our time, really. Everything that we hold dear and everything that we care about and just life as we know it is at stake. And so you would think when the stakes are that high that people would be really taking action, that the media would be covering it, all of the deaths that the fossil fuel industry has caused. You'd think that there would be bipartisanship among politicians to make laws to quickly better this, because it's really not a partisan thing to breathe air and have clean water and, survive. To the way that people are seeing that the NRA owns our government, the same thing goes for the fossil fuel industry. They pay to fund politicians' campaigns, and in return, politicians do them favors, like making it easier for them to get away with the destruction and death that they're causing. Honestly, I don't know why hurricanes are named such pretty names like Maria and Harvey. They should be named like Hurricane Exxon, Hurricane Chevron, Hurricane Shell. The amount that storms are getting worse, the amount of people who are dying in them exponentially, this is all because of the fossil fuel industry, and they know. They know the destruction they're causing, and people don't think of it like that. They just think of it as, pollution and it's bad for the planet, but there have been so many people who have died that the media hasn't covered, people who have gotten sick because of the effects and gotten cancer and died. Ever since after the Women's March, when I saw the power of mass mobilization, I thought, what if kids did this around climate change? That would change everything. With this march, with this rally, with our lobby day, we're taking back our power and we're making people listen to the voices of the youth and listen to the people that are often not listened to, but who are going to be the most affected by this crisis. I'm under voting age. I'm 16 years old, so I don't have a say in the politicians that we elect. I don't have a say in the policies that are made, but then me and my generation get to pay the biggest price for the consequences of those policies, and we get to live in that world of destruction that our leaders have left for us.
Incredible, incredible. Listen, Jamie, as you pointed out, this has really started with just a few people. It has grown unbelievably. I think the real key here is you mobilizing more and more and more and more people, because I think that's where the power is going to lie. I agree with you at this point. The power structure, with other than the few selected politicians, it's beyond their abilities, capabilities. But I think the mobilization, what Francis Piven and Richard Clower would call the census politics, pushing from below. Creating the awareness and the strategies and policies that bring more and more people into protest mode is really what's going to make your movement a success, which I believe it can and has to be. What do you think about that? You mentioned the Sunrise Movement, and Francis Piven has really been very prominent in that as well. You there? Are you familiar with her work and the strategy, the dissensus tactics, working outside the system to create enough pressure from outside?
That's really what Zero Hour focuses
exactly.
on. That's really what we do is we would. So that's really our main strategy. However, I think that there is no one supreme strategy that we have to enforce amongst everything. That also is the colonial mindset of just kind of one thing to enforce, and that everyone has to conform to that, and that's the way to fight this. We have to be fighting this at all different strategies and angles. So Zero Hour, what we do is the mobilization aspect, the building public anger, public pressure to put on these systems and these institutions of power. Then there is also the grassroots approach, which is okay, what can we do now in our community, because while we're waiting for these systems to change, because that's going to take a while and we have to take action now. Then there's the legal approach. Then there's the lobbying approach. Then there's so many approaches that have to be taken. That's what I said before, everyone doing everything as much as possible. So I think that strategy is what we focus on, but that's not the sole strategy to end the climate crisis. It's just what we're doing. And Sunrise Movement is doing as well.
How much do you see it as a moral issue?
100% it's a moral issue. If you think about the meaning of life, and you think about, at least the biological meaning, which is to keep your species going forward, this is pretty much hitting the self-destruct button, not only on humanity, but for all life on Earth. And it's just so unfair for my generation to have to live pretty much be handed down an unlivable planet, an unlivable future, chaos, uncertainty, violence. This is just, if you care about life on Earth at all, you know what's so funny to me is all of these pro-life politicians will be out here being like, oh, we care so much about life, save the fetus, you know, all these like abortion bans and stuff happening right now. And I'm just like, oh, honey, if you were actually pro-life, why aren't you saving all life on Earth? Why aren't you, why are you siding with politicians over these industries' life? Like, if you're gonna say you're pro-life, then be consistent. Like, why are you supporting all of these wars? Why are you supporting that is the military-industrial complex, which is really helping cause the climate crisis, and we're going to war over oil a lot of the time, which is the component of the climate crisis. So it's, we're colonizing and we're ruining the Earth and we're creating violence. It's a whole mess. And the climate crisis destroys life on Earth. It poisons people. The fossil fuel industry poisons people, kills animals. It's already making people, you know, refugees all over the world, all over the country. A lot of people fleeing violence at the border crisis right now. Some of that violence is worsened by, you know, lack of resources and the climate crisis happening and hitting these countries really, really hard. And so it's really a moral issue, which is why I get so disgusted when I turn on the TV and I see all these Christian politicians, right? Like, they don't actually align, like what you were saying. Me personally, I'm Jewish, but I'm pretty atheist. Like, I'm not very religious, but I know a lot about like religion, and I study it, and I go to a Catholic school. It's a whole thing. So I've been like studying religions, even though I kind of see it from apart, because I'm more of like the cultural Jewish versus like the whole, I don't really do the whole God thing, but I see the
I'm with you on all this. Go ahead, Ty.
I see all these people touting religion and touting how moral they are and getting up on talk shows and being like, oh, Jesus, and you know, using their religion as an excuse lately for these abortion bans, while they support these corporations destroying life on Earth. And so it's just been really disgusting to watch. Of like, if you're gonna say that you're a moral person, that you're a religious person, be consistent with what your religion says. Because I didn't hear Jesus saying, blessed are Shell Oil and Exxon, blessed be the greedy and the rich. Bible I read.
You know why you didn't hear him say that? Because he never did. So there you go. Listen, I'm from the same background, secular humanist. I gotcha. Listen, just a few seconds we have left. One more time, Jamie, how do we reach you? How do people register for this summit?
So I don't want you just watching me in this segment and be like, okay, cool, that girl's cool, whatever, turn the TV channel and then you forget about it. I really want you to see this interview and continue to be engaged. And we at 0 Hour have created a movement where everyone can be engaged of all ages. So if you want to connect with me personally, follow the work that I do, or just hit me up and we can chat and build something together, reach me on social media. I'm Jamie Margolin on Instagram and Jamie Margolin on Twitter and Jamie Margolin on Facebook. The Instagram and Twitter accounts, it's my face, it's verified, it's very, like, you can very much tell it's me, so just follow and shoot me a message and we can talk. If you want to get involved with the 0 Hour movement, go to thisiszerohour.org to register. A registration link will pop up on the website. Go to thisiszerohour.org/Miami to learn more about the summit, who's speaking, how you can get involved, so that way you can register for the summit. And I really hope to see everyone as possible in Miami.
We really do. And Jamie, we've reached 0 Hour here too. Jamie, thank you so much.
Thank you so
much. Maybe running for president in, I don't know, whatever, 20 years or so. Jamie, fabulous. Thank you so very, very much for being on The Radical Imagination. We'll see you again next week. And we're going to close with Mercy, Mercy Me, Marvin Gaye. Thank you so much. Jim Vrettos here. See you next week. Thank you, Jamie, so very much.
All things ain't what they used to be now. Where did all the blue skies go? Poison is the wind that blows from the north and south and east. Oh, mercy, mercy me. All things ain't what they used to be now. Oil, oh, well,
wasted on the oceans and upon our seas, fish full of mercury. Oh, oh, mercy, mercy me. Oh, things ain't what they used to be. Lost my radiation underground and in the sky. Animals and birds who live nearby are alive. Mercy, mercy me. All things and what they used to be. What about this overcrowded land? How much more we use from man? Can't you stand?